Welcome everyone. Today we are going to see the first type of crossbill tube that is called as magnetron. Okay, so the magnetrons were the first high power microwave source. They can be used as an oscillator as well as an amplifier. So all the magnetrons can consist of some form of the anode and cathode arrangement. Both are operated under a DC magnetic field. And as this is a cross-filled tube, the DC magnetic field is normal to the electric field that is generated between cathode and anode. So the electrons emitted from cathode, we have seen previously also in linear beam types tube, cathodes are used to emit the electrons. So electrons emitted from cathode are influenced by this crossed field. Crossed field means they are perpendicular to each other, magnetic field and electric field. And because of this cross field, these electrons deviate into a curved path. Okay, so that is how electrons will deviate because of presence of cross field. Okay, if the DC magnetic field is strong enough, so if you keep the DC magnetic field strong, usually magnetic field is in the Z direction, that is this direction. So if this is too large than this one, then electrons will not arrive at anode. So anode would be here, let's say. So electrons will not arrive at anode, but instead return to the cathode. So that will come back to the cathode. And by making such arrangement, we can achieve oscillator. Okay, this will be considered as a positive feedback and it will force it to be an oscillator. Okay, if you want it to be acting as a amplifier, you can keep this field greater than magnetic field, which is in Z direction, that is this direction. Okay, so that is how magnetron will work, similar to some sort of reflex klystron, but this is a cross field tube, remember this. So electron beams will be traveling through a cross field. Okay, so because of making this magnetic field greater than the radial field, that is your electric field, anode current will be cut off because electrons won't reach the anode, and that means anode current will be cut off, and because of that we will achieve oscillations of electron in around the cathode. So in general, magnetrons are classified into basic three types. First is a split anode, second is cyclotron frequency, and third is a traveling wave. So in the split anode magnetron, it uses a property of negative resistance between two anode segments. Okay, so it uses two anodes and it uses a property of static negative resistance of these two anodes for generating desired results, whether it's as a amplifier or oscillator. So what is negative resistance? Negative resistance, usually we know that V is equal to IR. That means if voltage is increased, current will also increase, because resistance goes down. Okay, now negative resistance means if voltage is increased, the resistance also increases, and because of that current goes down. So that is called as a negative resistance. So in case of negative resistance devices, if we keep increasing the voltage, current flowing through the device will slow down and it will go down. Okay, so that is the concept used in split anode magnetrons. Then in the second type, it operates under the influence of synchronism between alternating components of electric and periodic oscillation of electrons in a direction parallel to the field. Okay, so what it is using? It is using influence of synchronicity between electric field, which is in this direction, and oscillations of electron in a direction parallel to this particular field. So this synchronicity, so synchronicity means what? If electric field has a velocity which is given by, let's say, V, then this electrons which are moving parallel to the direction of this field, then they should also move with velocity V. Okay, so this relation is used for making this magnetron work as a desired device. okay, so that is cyclotron frequency magnetron. And third one, that is traveling wave magnetron, it is the most basic and conventional type of magnetron. It depends on interaction of electrons with traveling electromagnetic field of linear velocity. So linear velocity is important. We know electromagnetic field is traveling through the tube and it should have a linear velocity. That means velocity should be changing at a constant rate, and the interaction is dependent on electrons and the traveling electromagnetic field. So these are customarily referred to as simply as a magnetrons, because these are the most basic form of a magnetrons. So first two types are not used quite frequently because they produce very small output power, that is about 1 watt at 3 gigahertz, and their efficiency is also very low. That is, for split anode it is about 10%, and with for cyclotron, that is single anode, it is about 1%. So usually traveling wave magnetrons are preferred over the first two types, and that's what we are going to do. We are going to see first type of, or only traveling wave type of magnetron, that is known as a cylindrical magnetron. Cylindrical because its structure is cylindrical in nature. So it is a traveling wave magnetron. The schematic diagram of cylindrical magnetron used as an oscillator is shown on your screen. It is also called as a conventional magnetron. So let's look at the schematic. So if you see, the external periphery is your anode. Cathode is also a cylinder which is at the center of the external anode cylindrical structure. Okay, so this is also cylindrical, that is cathode, and this is also cylindrical, that is anode. That's why it is called as a cylindrical magnetron. So since the structure or geometry is cylindrical, for analysis we will have to use cylindrical coordinates R, phi and z. Okay, so input is given, or in case of my oscillations, input does not need to be given because the DC electric field or DC voltage supply is sufficient for generating the electron oscillation, or small input may also be given. So output is taken from the anode here, so that will be generated oscillations of the electron. Okay, now R, phi, z, the radius of cathode cylinder is A. If you observe here, radius of cathode cylinder is A, and radius of anode cylinder is B. Obviously you can see B is greater than A. Okay, again one more thing is to be observed, is anode is not directly touching the cathode, so there should be a gap between this anode and cathode. Okay, otherwise the working is not achieved and desired oscillations will not be achieved. Another thing, the cathode is supplied with the DC voltage V0, as well as anode is supplied with the DC voltage V0. So this DC voltage will generate an electromagnetic field around a cathode. Now magnetic field will be in the Z direction, that is this one, it is assumed to be positive Z direction, and electric field will be along the radial direction, that is ER. So that is considered as a radial component of a electric field, and these are cross fields because this is positive Z direction and this is radial direction, so this is a normal to each other. Okay, so that's why it will deviate the electrons in a cycloidal path. That means you can see the gaps between the different, these are cavities, these are nothing but cavities, these are nothing but gaps. Okay, so due to that the electrons will follow the cycloidal path along the cavity like this one. Okay, we will see that path in the next diagram. So let's look at the path. In a cylindrical magnetron, several reentrant cavities are connected to the gaps. Okay, so cavities are used inside anode structure. The DC voltage V0 is applied between cathode and anode, and magnetic flux density B0 is in the positive Z direction. Okay, so when DC voltage and the magnetic flux are adjusted properly, The electrons will follow cycloidal path. Just as I said, you can see that cycloidal path over here. Electrons are traveling in the cycloidal path around cathode through the reentrant cavities. Okay, this is a top view. Cycloidal path, and in cathode anode space under the combined force of both electric and magnetic fields. So combination of electric and magnetic field will force them to travel this particular path. We have already said, if the magnetic field or magnetic flux density is too much greater than electric field, then this will never reach the anode. Okay, these electrons will never reach the anode, and that's what we are trying to achieve over here. Okay, so let's do the analysis of electron motion. So let's see what are the equations related to electron motion, how to achieve these oscillations, and what should be the conditions. So the equations of motion of electron in a cylindrical magnetron can be written as given on your screen. So how this equation is created? Now motion of electron, that means its acceleration, will be in two directions, one in the radial direction and another in the z direction. Okay, because in the radial direction we have electric field and in the z direction we have magnetic field. So the motion of electron will be primarily in these two directions. Okay, so the components that we are going to consider, so motion of electron will be in the r direction and phi direction, because z direction we have a magnetic field which will force to move electrons from radial towards the angular direction. So we are going to consider only r and phi. Let me correct it. So motion of electron in the r and phi direction, because flux density, magnetic flux density, is in z direction. This is for causing electron motion in the phi direction. So this acceleration is nothing but second order derivative of a displacement. So in the radial direction, what we get? d2r by dt square. And since it is deviated by a magnetic flux density, we are using negative sign. And second order derivative in the phi direction will be r d phi by dt square. Okay, and it will be equal to, so this is nothing but your kinetic energy, which should be equal to your potential energy. Now let's see what will be the equation. E by m into a radial direction, that is er, because in the radial direction er is causing the radial movement. So E by m is nothing but charge of electron divided by mass of electron, or E by m is known as charge to mass ratio of a electron. Okay, and in the radial direction it is caused by the z component of a magnetic flux density. So E by m, again same, and r d phi by dt caused by the bz. So bz into r d phi by dt is the angular component of the motion of electron in the phi direction. Okay, and it's called, and it is multiplied by this E by m. So that is how it is created. If you rearrange this all entire equation, you will get this equation. So as I said, b0 is equal to bz is assumed to be in positive z direction. So if we rearrange second equation, that is this one, if we rearrange the second equation, we will get a following form. So that is this form, d by dt r square d phi by dt is equal to E by m bz r dr by dt. Now this is assumed to be 1/2, since it is in angular motion, or this equation is in the angular direction. It is given by a omega c, which is known to be cyclotron angular frequency. Now what is omega c? Now omega c is nothing but E by m, which is a charge to mass ratio multiplied by magnetic flux density. This is very important equation. So the angular frequency, and in turn the frequency of oscillation of electrons, can be found out using this particular equation. Of course it will be affected by the radial component er, and we are going to see its effect later on. But right now, remember, this is a very important equation. Okay, so let's move on. So integrating this above equation will yield this factor. So let's see. So if we integrate this, what it will give you is a r square d phi by dt. Okay, r square d phi by dt, because this integration will get cancelled, and integration of this term plus constant. Integration of this term plus constant. Okay, now at r is equal to a, now we know that what is a? A is a radius of cathode cylinder. Okay, and d phi by dt is 0. Okay, at r is equal to a, that means in the radial direction, d phi by dt will be 0, because d phi by dt is a angular component, and constant will be equal to 1 minus of 1 half omega c a square. So the angular velocity is expressed by d phi by dt 1 half omega c, r square is taken common and given here, into 1 minus a square upon r square. Okay, so simply rearranging this equation with these values, you will get this equation. So this is a component of angular velocity. Okay, since the magnetic field does not work on the electrons, since the magnetic field does no work on the electrons, the kinetic energy of electron is given by this one. This we have seen in the previous tubes also, tube workings also. Kinetic energy is equal to potential energy. Potential energy is given by E into V. E is a mass charge on electron, and V is a supplied voltage. Whereas this V square is a velocity of electron. M is a mass of electron. Now using this equation and this equation, we can find out the conditions. So however, the electron velocity has a R and phi components, we know that. So velocity is Vr square plus V phi square. That is nothing but dr by dt square and r d phi by dt square. This is the radial component, and this is, so this radial and angular component both are considered for finding the electron velocity. So at r is equal to b, so now b is nothing but, we know that radius of outer edge of the anode is the radius of the center of the cathode to the edge of the anode. Okay, so at that V is equal to V0, and radial component will be 0 in that case. So in that case, the electron will just guess the anode equation for d phi by dt, and V square will become only in terms of d phi by dt. So this component becomes 0 for R is equal to B. So that it should be, remember, for R is equal to B, this component becomes 0, and this R is now B, and d phi by dt will be given by 1 of omega c into 1 minus a square upon b square, considering R is equal to B. So rearranging this, or rearranging the previous equation, that is this one, we'll get b square d phi by dt square, that is this one, is equal to 2 e by m into v0. Okay, now in this equation, this is nothing but kinetic energy is equal to potential energy. Now in this equation, if we substitute d phi by dt is equal to this equation, what we will get? So you have to substitute simply this term here. So what we will get? B square into 1 half omega c 1 minus a square upon b square, entire bracket square, is equal to 2 e v0 upon m. This, the electron will acquire tangential as well as radial velocity. Okay, because omega c is nothing but e by m b. Okay, so remember this thing. So whether the electron will just gaze the anode or return toward the cathode, and return toward the cathode on the relative magnitudes of v0 and b0. So it depends on v0 and b0. V0 is a DC voltage and b0 is a magnetic flux density. So based on these two components, it will depend that whether electrons return toward the cathode or not. So this condition has to be achieved in order to make magnetron work as an oscillator. Okay, so Hall cutoff magnetic equation, which is the equation that must be satisfied in order to make magnetron work as an oscillator, can be obtained from this above equation. So how we are going to obtain that? B0C, because substituting omega c is equal to E by m, let's say that is a B0C, because that is our cutoff condition now. Okay, so substitute that here and rearrange, so you will get B0C is equal to this equation. So this is a Hall cutoff magnetic equation. So if this magnetic flux density is achieved, we can say that we can force the magnetron to work as an oscillator. So how we can force him? So if we keep magnetic flux density greater than this cutoff magnetic flux density for a given V0, then electrons will not reach anode and it will be forced to work as a oscillator. Or if we are talking about the voltage and not in terms of the magnetic flux density, then what will be the condition? Let's see that. So conversely, the cutoff voltage is given by this equation. That means if V0 is less than cutoff voltage equation for given magnetic flux density, electrons will not reach the anode and it will be worked as a, or magnetron will work as a oscillator. So this equation of V0C is often called a Hall cutoff voltage equation. So in conclusion, in order to magnetron to work as an oscillator, there are two primary things which are important or which are required to be satisfied. First thing, B0, that is magnetic flux density, should be greater than B0C. And second, V0, that is DC voltage applied between anode and cathode, should be less than V0C. Whereas B0C and V0C are called as Hall cutoff magnetic field flux density and magnetic voltage, Hall cutoff voltage equation. Okay, so that is the condition for magnetron to work as an oscillator. Okay, so that's all about magnetron. In the next video, we will see other two types of the cross field tubes. These are called as cross field amplifiers and gyrotron. So that's all for today. Thank you.